Skints, you're watching reggae-riddims.ch.
Das ist reggae-riddims.ch und meine heutigen Gäste sind die Skints aus England.
Hey.
Hey.
Hello.
Hey, what's up? Okay.
Describe the Skints in three words.
Magical, radical adventure.
You agree with?
I agree. I agree. Those are good ones.
Hey yo! You tuned into the Skints from London Town. Are the biggest thing.
I always see your tour plan, and it's just amazing. Every day, another show. What do you think? How many shows do you play in a year?
I think the most shows we've ever done in a year is about 160. So, but on average, we play between 100, 150 shows a year.
Pretty much. One aspect which is very nice of touring is playing live, being on stage. But what aspects do you hate so much?
Oh, we don't like to think negatively. Okay. But, you know, I mean, every band in the world will say that it's difficult being away from your loved ones, and it's difficult sometimes having to be away at times when you don't, you know, necessarily want to. But again, it's like that with any job. There are negative parts, and you're not going to have a good time if you focus on them. So, yeah. And the positives definitely outweigh any negative parts.
Yeah, I mean, we love it. If we didn't want to be here, we wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
So it's cool, yeah.
Well, Boris Gay was in my heart, and the bar was in my arteries to get started with the parties, wolf and soul become a part of me. I'm bunning all that wolf.
Now you are four people in the band, and when I listen to Part and Parcel, the LP, I hear different voices. who's singing in your band? Do you have a lead vocalist?
We have three singers in the band, and all three sing lead at different times, you know, and that
and
I guess, yeah, and together, exactly. We've spent a few years trying to perfect both singing lead respectively, but also working together to back the other up, or sometimes to create one voice, or we work together a lot to get different sounds. We play around with that. Yeah.
So it was not that you couldn't decide who should be the front person.
No, it's just like a natural development, yeah. You know, and the more you play together and the more you write songs, you figure out, you know, it comes naturally. You figure out what sounds good, rather than, you know, the whole band has been like a growing process, you know, from okay, let's do a gig, let's do a couple of gigs, let's do a tour, let's do an album, you know, all that time and experience is when you learn what sounds good, rather than, you know, making a band and 5 minutes later you're like everywhere, you know, hasn't really had time to grow. But with us, we've had a lot of time to grow, a lot of time to develop, and I think it's for the best for us anyway.
Okay, the first song I heard from you was Ratatat.
You could be a little better, but you had a better friend of me. Instead of I know you can get a life and no other hearing knocking on your door with a rat's tap tap.
And after 5 seconds I knew this band must be from England. What do you think is very... Do you think your music is kind of British sound? Does it sound British and what?
Yeah, I mean, I think our music reflects where we're from. We kind of, you know, we wear... where we're from, like on our sleeves, and we talk about it a lot. And I think if we were from anywhere else in the country, let alone the world, it would sound completely different anyway. So yeah, I think definitely where we're from is a big part of our music and our lives, really. So yeah, it's cool.
And London has always new styles, and right now it's like dubstep is it's the main thing, I think. And you play more the retro, ska and reggae. How do you get into this old stuff?
We're all like huge music fans. We listen to a lot of different kinds of music. And when we were growing up and finding out about new stuff, the four of us were just very much interested in where that music came from before and before then and before then. So it's just, as like record buyers and as music listeners, we're just very interested in like who the originals were, you know? So, and I think we try in our own way and try and be like originals ourselves, whilst taking influence from so many different styles and whatnot, you know? So it's just about, for us it's like, you know, kind of like immersing yourself in the music and taking as much as you can from it, rather than what's happening today or even worse, what's happening tomorrow, and trying to keep up, you know? We like what we like, and so we make music in that way.
It's important to really know, not necessarily textbook, but the history of the music that you make, and to know where it's come from and maybe how it was developed, because you can only really then give it the respect it deserves and also reproduce it correctly. You know, when you start, say, taking influence from maybe more modern music that takes influence from that without paying attention to where it came from, you'll just water down the music more and more, and that's what happens today, perhaps too much.
Where is it today, the British reggae scene?
The British reggae scene is currently very underground. Nowadays, it's definitely a thing that is more dominated by sound systems and DJs, which is no bad thing, because, you know, there's some great English sound systems, there's some great English MCs and DJs and stuff. As for live bands, you know, in the 80s you had groups like Steel Pulse and Aswad. You know, there's maybe not so much of that anymore. I think a lot of the problem is the British music media has kind of, rather than, I think in Europe, like in Germany and France, from what I can see, is that reggae songs respected among all other genres. It's like, if it's good music, it's good music. But I think in England, the case is that they want to put it in like this like obscure subgenre somewhere in like the urban section, along with like world music and like whatever, when really and truly it shouldn't, just because it's got the word attached to it or whatever. But you know, every time we go out and play at like a big, at like a mainstream event, everyone loves it and they're like, oh yeah, I love reggae. But I just think it's something that the media has just kind of ignored for a long time, but hopefully that's about to change, because there is some really good stuff out there.
You have two albums out, and the latest was produced by Prince Fatty. What's the difference between the first and the second, and what's the influence by working with Prince Fatty?
I think, well, the first album, we recorded it in 5 days, and you know, for not much budget, and it was like the first like body of work. It was like the first thing that we tried to, it was the first time we tried to write an album, you know, and I think that shows, and for what it was at the time, you know, we're very proud of it. The second album, obviously, in between the first one and the second one, we had like 2 years of like solid touring and writing songs. So like I said, the development was a few steps up, And obviously working with Prince Fatty, he's much more like a specialist, like a reggae specialist producer, rather than just, you know, someone who's very good at producing lots of different things. Prince Fatty is like his forte, his reggae music, and yeah, I think that's reflective in the work.